नमस्ते, गुड इवनिंग टू इंडिया एंड गुड इवनिंग टू अमेरिका एंड ए वेरी वेरी गुड डे टू द रेस्ट ऑफ द वर्ल्ड. माय हार्टी वेलकम टू ऑल ऑफ यू. वी आर गोइंग टू स्टार्ट ए ग्रेट सीरीज ऑफ लेक्चर्स, सेल्फ रिलायंट इंडिया, आत्मनिर्भर भारत, ए विजन. टुडे आई हैव द प्लेजर ऑफ इंट्रोड्यूसिंग टू Distinguished individuals. To begin with, the first one is Sri Jayant Rao Sahasrabuddhe. Originally, he is from Girgaon, Mumbai. His parents were workers of both RSS, Rashtriya Swayamsevak Sangh, and Rashtra Sevika Samiti. The samskara has led him to become the Pracharak. After his BSc in Tech Electronics, he worked for some time in BARC, Baba Atomic Research Center, and since 1989, he has been Pracharak. For the first about 18 years, he was a Pracharak in different parts of Maharashtra, and finally Vibhag Pracharak of Goa, and also Prant Pracharak of Konkan. Interestingly, in between, he was also personal secretary to H.V. Seshadri. For me, what is very compelling and impressive is his extensive studies on the lives of Swami Vivekananda, P.C. Ray, Jagdish Chandra Bose, Bhagini Nivedita. He also delivered several lectures on these personalities. Since 2007, he has been assigned the responsibility of Akhila Bharatiya Sanghatan Mantri of Vignan Bharati. Since then, he is constantly and continuously guiding many different wings of existing options. Plus, he has also started some new initiatives. There's a long list, but for today's context, I'm going to refer into only two of them. In the month of November in 2019, an event was held, India International Science Festival in Kolkata. In that event, the thousands of students performing science experiments at the same time, which entered into the Guinness Book of World Records. The second, which is very relevant for us, is Global Indian Scientists and Technocrats Forum. This is a wing of Vignan Bharati, and under which the series of lectures is being organized. The second person whom I am going to introduce is Dr. Shekhar C. Mande. He is from Nagpur. He did his undergrad and master's in University of Nagpur. And then he had few years of fellowships in Netherlands, in Seattle, USA. Then he was also scientist in the Center for DNA Fingerprinting and Diagnostics, which is located in Hyderabad. Later, he became the director of National Center for Cell Science, which is located in Pune. Since 2018, October, he is a secretary of DSIR and director general of Council of Scientific and Industrial Research, located in New Delhi. Personally, we were contemporaries in the Indian Institute of Science, and our acquaintance goes more back 3 decades. With that, I will hand over to Sri Jayant Sahasrabuddhe, who is going to talk a little bit about Vignan Bharati and also GIST, and then he will hand it over to Dr. Mande. Jayant ji.
Namaste, Yeloji Rao. Thanks for introducing me and our expert speaker, Dr. Shekharji Mande. So I offer my namaskar to everyone who are present in this session. I welcome you all to this new initiative of Vignan Bharati, named as GIST, Global Indian Scientists and Technocrats Forum. As we know that this is an initiative of Vignan Bharati. So let me first introduce in brief about Vignan Bharati. Vidyan Bharati is a national science movement of Bharat. It is popularly known as a science movement with Swadeshi spirit. So it is a Swadeshi science movement of Bharat. And this idea of Swadeshi has two different dimensions. On one hand, we say that it is a movement for Swadeshi sciences. Swadeshi sciences means Indian sciences or sciences which have been developed in India through ages. We know that there is a great need to protect, preserve, or conserve this great scientific heritage we are having in our country. So Vidyan Bharati is working in that direction to protect and preserve our scientific heritage, the scientific legacy which we have received through past generations. So that is one aspect of Vidyan Bharati's work. On the other hand, Swadeshi means a self-reliance. So Vidyan Bharati's one of the greatest objectives is we want to make our country self-reliant in all aspects of life with the intervention of science and technology. So Vidyan Bharati takes care of this particular aspect, that how we will be able to make use of scientific and technological tools for the development of Bharat. And today we are happy, though Vidyan Bharati's work has started in 1991 at Nagpur, but today we see or experience that self-reliance or Atmanirbharta has become a focal theme or central theme of public discourse or deliberations in our country. So we are happy about it. And what Vidyan Bharati has been doing over 3 decades, so people have endorsed that idea. And now everyone is thinking about how we will be able to make our country self-reliant through science and technology in every walk of life. So Vidyan Bharati is very happy about it. Vidyan Bharati has developed several activities, programs, and there are several initiatives of Vidyan Bharati based on this vision. And GIST, Global Indian Scientists and Technocrats Forum, is one amongst many such initiatives. Now we have almost 11 streams through which Vidyan Bharati is working towards achieving its objectives. And this is a new initiative. As we know that GIST, Global Indian Scientists and Technocrats, is an integrating platform for Indian scientists and technocrats working in India as well as abroad. We know that great number of brilliant Indian scientists are working in different countries of the world, and they are significantly contributing to the development of modern science and technology. Leaders in India in science and technology had a thought that can we utilize these significant contributions of Indians for the development of science and technology in the developmental process of India? Can we make use of their scientific knowledge and utilize that knowledge in solving present day problems of our country, and how we will be able to develop and regain prosperity of our country through the intervention of science and technology? So with this idea in mind, Vidyan Bharati and illustrious scientists in India, those who are having this kind of idea in their mind, we came together and we formed this platform. We were fortunate enough to get Dr. Abdul Kalam to inaugurate this functioning of GIST Forum. And we were happy to get him at Pune in 2010, where he was presiding that function, inaugural function of GIST Forum. And he handed over the leadership of this forum to another eminent scientist in our country, Dr. Anilji Kakodkar. So we are having blessings of this illustrious scientists of our country, and they are our guiding force. They are mentoring this kind of platform, and we have started with this initiative with the blessings of these eminent people. So recently, we have started our chapter in United States of America, and we are fortunate enough to get Dr. Yellowji Rao as a convener for that US chapter of GIST. And we are confident that in a short time in future, we will be able to spread these activities of GIST Forum in many parts of the world. And we thought that let us initiate some activities, though we are in this present day scenario of pandemic or crisis of COVID-19. So we thought that we should initiate some activity, online kind of activity. And we thought that let us start with this series of lectures through webinars. So in that series, we are going to have first session today, and our expert speaker is Dr. Shekharji Mande. Dr. Yellowji Rao has already introduced Dr. Shekhar Mande. At present, he is having responsibility as a Director General of CSIR. CSIR is one of the main scientific body of our country, and which has started even before we got independence in India. So it has a great legacy, and we know that scientific development in India has taken place through many such eminent organizations, and CSIR is one very prominent amongst them. So today we have Dr. Shekharji Mande with us, and we are also fortunate enough to have his association with Vidyan Bharati also. So it is a great confluence of many such speakers and experts and scientists of our country on this forum. He was also there at IISF, which has already been mentioned by Dr. Yellowji Rao, that we had a kind of brief program at IISF Kolkata in 2019. And Dr. Shekharji Mande was also there, and he has presented so many things for our members who came from different countries over there in Kolkata. So I just welcome all of you again to this session, and I request Dr. Shekhar Mande to deliver his talk in this session. So over to Dr. Shekharji Mande.
Thank you. Good morning to all of our friends in the US. Good morning to all of our friends in US, and good evening to all the friends in India. It's a great privilege for me to be able to present a few of my thoughts to all of you in this particular forum. As has already been told to you by my good friend Yellowji Rao, that we had this very nice Indian International Science Festival in Calcutta in November, and where we actually sat together, and we talked quite a lot about how do we engage the global science and technology community of Indian origin for the development of our own nation. And I think that is a very good thought, and as Jainji has told you, this had begun with the blessings of none other than Dr. Abdul Kalam and Dr. Anil Kakodkar. So we are actually trying to take forward that legacy. And I am particularly privileged, therefore, that I am giving this particular address today, the first address at this particular forum. JNG has already mentioned, I have had very fond association with Vigyan Bharati, starting from the days of Swadeshi Science Movement in IISc Bangalore, but even more in the last few years. So, and as an organization, we are very proud that we would like to inculcate feelings amongst everyone, that science has been extremely well developed in our country over the years. It's only in between there was some period in which we were kind of suppressed with our own ideas and all, but it is once again taking shape very well in the last couple of decades or so. In fact, we have made a remarkable progress since 1947. If we look back upon that time and today, there's absolutely remarkable progress that has happened in Bharat compared to many other countries which became independent at that particular point of time. Now, I want to start with one thought. You don't have to agree with this thought. I don't even have to agree with that thought, but was expressed very rampantly about 20, 25 years ago. Then many people used to make statements, and one of the statements that many of our science leaders used to make was, Indian genes express very well in the Silicon Valley, but they don't express as well in the Indus Valley. Now, what it meant was, Indian brains, when they go out of India, they do exceptionally well. And we are very proud of all the S&T community of India, which is residing overseas even today. The kind of contributions they have made to the modern world of knowledge is exemplary. But then till 20 years ago, the concern was that why our own brains are not contributing as significantly to India's growth. As I said, we don't have to agree or disagree with this particular view. Our people also have, being in Bharat, have done exceptionally well. And we see the fruits of that over the years, that how we have brought in many different kinds of revolutions. Right? I mean, we all talk of green revolution, we talk of white revolution, and if you are going to talk about blue revolution, that is IT revolution, all have been possible only with the proper applications of science and technology. And that actually has happened here, right, being in the country in our district. Today, we have some concerns about self-reliance, and these concerns have grown in the last 3 months, especially in this exceptional time that we are passing through. And that actually has made many of us think that how can we actually make our country completely self-reliant? And Honorable Prime Minister has also given multiple calls, to begin with Make in India call a few years ago. Two more recent, to make it Atmanirbhar Bharat, has been a clarion call that has been given. What I will come to the towards the end of my talk is, Atmanirbhar Bharat does not necessarily mean Make in India or our capability of making things in India, but Atmanirbhar Bharat is a much larger concept where everything is kind of interconnected with Atmanirbharta. So let me start showing you in the beginning of my lecture, how much do we import in our country? Now, I hope you are able to see my slides. These are the imports that what our country makes today. The percentage is actually shown in different regions. For example, crude petroleum import today is of the order of about $100 billion in the country. And that constitutes roughly about 21% of all imports in the country. Well, that's a huge import. But that we can understand because we don't have natural resources in the country. And therefore, we necessarily have to depend upon foreign sources to get crude petroleum to our country. Similarly, we also import a lot of steel. We import almost all electronic goods. But we also import many of the essential medicines and so on and so forth in our country. Now, this is a matter of concern for all of us. On the right-hand side, what you see here are the imports that are categorized as per different countries that we import from. And we import totally about 15% of our imports are from China, about 4 or 5% are from Saudi Arabia, from United Arab Emirates, and from Iraq. So this is general profile of how actually we depend upon other nations to give us the raw material. There are two angles to importing these kind of materials from overseas. Now let me once again say, there are two fundamental differences in what we import. When we import things like crude petroleum, when we import things like steel, when we import things like cement, they have a component that these all go into our either infrastructure industry or or our energy sector. And because we don't have natural resources as many to keep Bharat Atmanirbhar. But there are solutions to this, S&T solutions to this, and we'll talk about that little later. On the other hand, there are many things that we import from other countries. For example, in pharmaceutical sector, we are now quite dependent upon countries like China. And this was not the case about 20 years ago. Our pharma sector or our chemical sector was not as dependent on China then. But over a period of time, we have become more and more dependent on that. And we have begun more importing. In the process, we have lost some of the art or capabilities of making things on our own. So this is a fundamental difference between the two. We have not lost art of making petroleum on our own. We still have some of the oil resources, which we tap very well. But we import them because we need that for our energy or infrastructure sector. On the other hand, certain other things that we have started importing over the years, because we found it easier or cheaper to import these atoms than making them on our own. In the process, we have lost the capability of making that. And instrumentation, electronics and all would probably come into that particular kind of category. As I told you, even importing things for our energy sector, things like oil, for example, I told you that we will have to depend on other nations because we don't have sufficient natural resources to meet our energy demands. But why not India actually get into things such as tapping these resources from available carbon atoms in the country? Essentially, these are all carbon atoms in the country. Can we not go into biodiesel, green diesel, or bio-based alcohols and ethers? Can we not actually start deriving green heavy distillates or biomass derived oils? We have plenty of biomass in the country, and whether it would be possible to do that. And what I've shown you on this slide are the examples of some of these. And I've highlighted CSIR here because CSIR has certain capabilities of making some of these, and indeed we should try to make some of these here. But the very fact that we want to connect with the global S&T community is also how global S&T community can also help us in prioritizing this and bringing the latest technologies or develop our own technologies of the highest quality and order in the world here. And that's exactly the purpose of connecting the global Indian science and technology diaspora on this particular platform. At stake, as I said, is roughly about $100 billion, which roughly translates to anywhere between 6 to about 8 lakh crore rupees per year. That's our crude import bill. And we have capability of reducing this bill by at least 25 to 30%. And you can imagine 25 to 30% of this figure can be a substantial figure in nation's economy. And we must think about this of doing that. In fact, if we are ambitious, we can even think of ourselves being a zero oil import country by something like 2040 or 2050. That should be our real aim. And that's where all of us should come together and think very seriously about that. Another important aspect of the energy sector is that the world is very rapidly moving towards other energy sources than petroleum. And one of the very attractive sources is the lithium-ion batteries. You know, I mean, a lot of world, because we want to reduce environmental impact, and therefore to reduce our dependence on fossil fuels, we would like to go to sources which are non-fossil fuel dependent. And lithium is one such source that one could actually think of tapping. We must remember that if we do that, instead of depending upon oil imports, we would be depending upon lithium imports from other countries, because we don't have our own source of lithium. And unlike oil, you cannot generate lithium out of natural resources, as what I had mentioned about oil. our principal dependence would be on, of course, China, countries like China, Hong Kong, Vietnam, or they also be some of the South American countries that we would be doing. Now, what are the possible solutions to this once again? And once again, it's important that a global Indian science and technology diaspora contributes to the possible solutions to such problems. For example, many people are talking of sodium-ion batteries as a possible future source. If indeed sodium-ion batteries become a possible future energy source, then there is no dearth of sodium resources anywhere. And then we will not be dependent on the lithium-ion import as what we would be in the current situation, as what is projected in this particular slide. And that's where actually science and technology interventions would be very, very important. And once again, I would like to appeal to all our overseas friends that we should join hands and try to think how we can make sodium ion batteries a reality so that we cannot depend upon other nations for this particular purpose. It is expected that the lithium ion battery market is set to grow at a CAGR of roughly about 32% in the next 1 or 2 years. And therefore, Elegant S&T Solutions is an order of real need for this particular purpose. What we would also like to do is look at now the pharma sector. Now, as I said, in petroleum sector or the steel is essentially which is related to energy or infrastructure, there are certain reasons that we import because we want to meet our needs of the nation in that particular sector. In the pharma sector, things are slightly different. In the pharma sector, till about 1980s or 1990s, we were completely self-dependent. In fact, our generic pharma industry did marvels, and our generic pharma industry became the major suppliers of generic drugs to many nations around the world, and we are very proud of that. We used to make pharmaceutical formulations starting from the starting materials, the APIs and the KSMs from the raw materials. However, over a period of time, we found it more easier and more economical to import this from other countries. Once the economics took over, it became more and more attractive to start importing APIs and KSMs from other countries, principally from China. And then our pharma industry, over a period of time, in a matter of about just 20 or 30 years, started depending more and more on China, so much so that today, many of the essential drugs in India are actually imported from other countries. Now that's a pity, because in the process, we have lost the art, we have lost the know-how of how do we make our own APIs and KSMs required for our pharma industry. And it's a great matter of concern. Unlike the infrastructure or energy sector that we saw, here it is not the need that drove our imports, but rather convenience that drove the imports. And we must remember in the long term, convenience cannot override the needs of a nation as a strategy. You know, we must have capability of doing everything here, and then if convenient, we can import things still. That's not a problem. But the thing is, convenience cannot override, in terms of priority, the need of the nation. These are most of these drugs are actually now have been identified, or many of these APIs have been identified, and the Department of Pharmaceuticals in the Ministry of Chemicals and Fertilizers has done a marvelous job recently. They have said that total 53 APIs are the key APIs that we are importing in the country right now, and we must have a national program of making these APIs in our own country. What would be the sources? The sources are plenty. The source for raw material are absolutely plenty. We have abundant raw material available in the country. For example, the byproducts from the petroleum industry, the byproducts from the coal, we can actually go to the drawing table and start using all these byproducts of those industries which are today discarded. But if you actually connect the petrochemical industry with the pharma industry, we would have very, very elegant solutions on reducing our imports at this stage. And let me assure you, we are at this stage in the middle of very, very intense brainstorming how we are going to do that. And let me assure you, in the next 15 days or 1 month, we'll roll out a plan that how do we make Bharat Atmanirbhar in all these 53 APIs, and hopefully with support from all of you, we will be able to continue our journey in this particular one. I want to give an example of industrial enzymes. You know, there are many, many enzymes which are required for many different processes, industrial enzymes. And a backward to forward integration of these resources is the need of the hour. We had this strength long ago of making our own industrial enzymes, but once again, over a period of time, we have lost this strength. And once again, my appeal to global Indian S&T diaspora is let us join hands and bring that art back to Bharat once again so that we don't depend upon this kind of things in future. I just want to give from the CSIR perspective that CSIR can contribute significantly in this sector, the chemical sector, the enzyme sector and all. And as I said, I assured you in the next 15 days or next 1 month, we'll roll out a plan so that CSIR can support all these APIs and KSMs and other areas such as many ancillary chemicals, including solvents, reagents, additives, etc., to support the local industry, chemical industry, as well as the pharma industry. And what I've shown you in those blue boxes are the names of different CSIR labs in red. And many of these labs can actually participate together as a joint program for the development of the nation. But once again, if the global Indian S&T diaspora, their help would be most important to get in this. Let me come to the third sector. We talked about energy and infrastructure. We talked of pharmaceuticals. And very briefly, let me also talk of metals, minerals, and materials. Now, in this, of course, we'll have to depend upon many nations because we may not have sufficient sources of things like raw zinc, raw aluminium, raw copper, and therefore we may have to depend upon other nations to produce our own, we may have limitations in producing our own things. But having said that, one could still try to recycle, you know, especially rare earths. If we recycle many of the electronic goods, if we recycle, then we would have to, we can reduce the imports of these very well, you know. And one must therefore find out proper S&T interventions to reduce imports by recycling many of our electronic atoms. And we are generating tons and tons and millions of tons of electronic waste every day in the country, and that actually is a rich resource for many of these rare earths. And therefore, there is a scope and there is an opportunity for S&T interventions in all of this. And this is just to actually show you what different things can be done and what would be CSIR strategy into this, such as exploiting secondary and tertiary resources, scaling up our capabilities, indigenizing the technologies for reverse engineering and scaling up, and do materials development. But once again, I would appeal to global community for this. And these are the minerals and materials that I actually have shown here that can be tapped from many different sources. One of the rich sources could be also deep ocean, what we call as polymetallic nodules. Now, this source has not been tapped till now. And polymetallic nodules also could potentially be a very good source of some of these metals. And maybe we should try to do that for our own things. And partnering agencies actually have listed on the right-hand side of the thing, such as the Ministry of Earth Sciences, Ministry of Steel, DRDO, and other things. All of us can get together with single mission of making Bharat an Atmanirbhar Bharat. In the area of mineral products, we also import a lot of coke for making steel. We also import a lot of petroleum coke. And the potential solution for this would be scaling up of the process to convert non-cooking coal to cooking coal. Now, this is a very deep science and technology that is required. We need to develop technologies. We have plenty of resources of non-cooking coal in the country, natural resources. But to convert that into cooking coal is the technology that what we require. And it will allow us to tap the large coal deposit that are in India. And then we can become once again Atmanirbhar in iron and steel making. In terms of electronic goods, I don't have to tell all of you, we are almost completely dependent on imports from places like such as Taiwan, Singapore, Hong Kong, and China. Most of the raw materials and things and all, they come from the countries in the east part of, in the eastern side of India. The potential solution of this would be to build our own capabilities in the semiconductor industry. And what we would need to do is set up many fab labs across the country. And we can all help together once again in setting up fab labs and allowing access to industries allowing access to our small and medium players to have access to these Fab Labs and once again try to become Atmanirbhar in this particular solution. This is one of my last slides. I have one last slide, of course, after this coming up. And this slide actually shows that one essential component of Atmanirbharta is to have our own standards. You know, for any quality infrastructure in the country, all across all developed economies of the world have their own reference standards. And today, we import more than 10,000 crores worth certified reference materials in our country. All these standards go on in measuring the quality of products. For example, making quality of chemicals, petroleum-related products, foods, water, biomedical, all of these require standards. And we must actually then do something so that we have our own standards. For example, today, the Indian Standard Time, which one of our laboratories, the National Physical Laboratory, maintains, is actually turned out to be a very good thing that what we have done. So National Physical Laboratory was given the objective of being a National Metrology Institute by the Act of Parliament in the 1950s. And it has done wonderfully well. By maintaining the Indian Standard Time and using India's own GPS system that the ISRO has developed, together we can reduce import by something like 100 crores. So in collaboration with ISRO, the NPL aims to reduce it to less than 1 crores in 3 years. And that actually is a very laudable effort, both by ISRO and by NPL. Similarly, environmental monitoring equipment, which are certified by foreign agencies, we also import roughly about 500 crores. And we can aim to reduce this to less than 100 crores in the next 2 years. So things like this are actually very important in generating our reduction of the import bills. I don't want to go on with different examples. Water is another strategy, wastewater treatment, water treatment for geogenic contaminants such as arsenic, or ultrafiltration and reverse osmosis membranes are other things that we actually import on a very large scale. Availability of potable waters in India is actually a problem. And mantra, therefore, would be vocal for local. So the policy level interventions to decrease imports would require quality criteria, life cycle, and guarantee. What we should impress upon the government, and our collective objective would be to impress upon the government, that every item that is imported must measure up to a particular standard. Unless it meets that particular standard, we should not import that item into the country. The second criteria should be to promote public-private partnerships. Many of you are aware, and many of you possibly left India long ago for the fact that Indian academia has been far removed from the Indian private industry. But in the last 5 or 6 years, things have changed very rapidly. The current government has recognized the fact that public-private partnership is a very powerful way of going ahead. And therefore, collectively, once again, we all should work together to make sure that academia and industry work together so that we reduce our dependence on imports possibly. So the possible strategies for decreasing imports are designed for recycle and reuse. I give you one example of rare earths. Banning or restricting material products which are for one-time use, there's one possible strategy. And environmental liability for future, there's another strategy. So a combination of all of these could be possibly used to make Bharat an Atmanirbhar Bharat. This is my last slide. I said that making Atmanirbhar Bharat, I made a comment in the beginning of my lecture, is not alone make in India. Atmanirbhar Bharat is a much larger concept. It's a much larger perspective. The concept is that in the long term, we must become self-dependent on our own thinking, our own infrastructure, and not only to India, but we should contribute to the whole world as gloriously as what we are doing till the 18th century. All of you would agree with me that we were among the most developed nations till about 18th century. We were contributing very richly to the world of knowledge around the world. We are contributing richly to the human thought and mind to the world. And we must regain that glory. And to do that, I appeal to all the global Indian S&T community to participate actively in all the research and development efforts in India. bring best practices of S&T to India, help garner support for reducing bureaucratic controls. As all of us know, that 70 years, we have had very tight bureaucratic controls over most of the things. But things, as I said, have been rapidly changing in the last 4 or 5 years. And if we actually prepare concept papers on how bureaucratic controls can be reduced on everything that we do in our normal life, and what are the kind of things that are observed, the best practices that are observed around the world in different nations, I think that would be a very, very welcome development. And that's where the global S&T community can advise us on what bureaucratic controls can be reduced so that we make atmosphere in India as conducive as anywhere else in the world. As I said, import substitution is not only making India, but also forecast for the future and be ready for it. One of the biggest lessons that we learned from the global pandemic of COVID-19 is that we were not prepared for it. And it's amazing. Despite so much of knowledge that we have garnered, and despite so much of progress that has been made in healthcare across the world, some of the most advanced countries are also some of the worst affected today by this particular pandemic. And we had not foreseen it. Well, the scientist community would say that we had foreseen it. In fact, we had been saying for the last 20 years that there are multiple things which are around a corner and they can come anytime now. The science and technology community has been saying this all along, that there is a global pandemic which is just around a corner. The science and technology community has always been saying that another big earthquake is around a corner. The science and technology community has been saying that an economic crash is around a corner. But most importantly, the science and technology community has been saying that the climate change is around a corner. Now, this data, which has been modeled across the world, and there's a consensus that these things are actually real. So they are not fears, but they are real. And we have actually failed in this pandemic, that in the last few years, although we had foreseen that a global pandemic is around the corner, we have not been able to impress upon the political leadership that how do we make ourselves best prepared for any pandemic that comes in future. And let us resolve that for future, at least we don't repeat this mistake and we be prepared for any such global pandemic that might be there around the corner in the coming years. We must also be prepared for climate change, and we must impress upon the political leadership around the world that climate change is real and therefore we should be prepared for it. I do hope by combining all these ideas, we will all be collectively able to evolve strategies for the long-term development of the country. Many of you know that India used to contribute roughly about 27 to 30% of world GDP till about 18th century. And we must regain that glory once again. Collectively, we can do it. Thank you all very much for your attention. If there are any comments, questions or something, I would request Yellowji if you can actually allow these comments or questions to be taken. And I would like to thank all of you for your attention. Jai Hind.
Namaskar. I am Srikant Kulkarni from Vijnan Bharati Pune and also a volunteer. That science and technology is a vehicle to develop solutions for the developmental problems of our country. Dr. Mande sir, who could have been a better person heading all the 37 CSR labs in India, giving guidelines for bringing up the concept of self-reliant India?
There is a question. on how do we make India self-reliant in the rural sector. And some of you might be aware that the current government has launched a very, very laudable effort called Unnat Bharat Abhiyan. You know, the Unnat Bharat Abhiyan responsibility has been given to IIT Delhi. IIT Delhi is the coordinating agency, but there are many other agencies which are also helping Unnat Bharat Abhiyan in that particular one. And we should very proudly say that even Vigyan Bharati in his Tech for Seva, I see Srikanji Kulkarni here, also has been helping Unnat Bharat Abhiyan in this particular respect. That CSIR also has decided to partner with Unnat Bharat Abhiyan to make sure that we should make rural sector as self-sufficient as possible. What we also saw, as I said, in the current pandemic is that there are many people who have gone from cities back to their rural roots. You know, there has been a large-scale reverse migration that has happened due to the global pandemic. Now, the reverse migration has obvious this particular fallout, and we should make sure that the people who are going back to their villages should be meaningfully employed, so that the society does not actually feel the disturbance from this particular aspect. And in this particular regard, Unnat Bharat Abhiyan, the Tech for Seva, and CSIR together have a real opportunity to get together and make sure that the people in rural areas have means of self-employment so that they can sustain on their own, in their own households and such and things. And we need to actually evolve solutions very quickly. We are running out of time. In the coming few days, we must get together once again and try to see how we can do at a very large scale. It will require partnership with private industries. It will require support from government. But moreover, it will require a large support from non-governmental organizations. And it will require support from voluntary organizations such as Vigyan Bharati. And let us resolve that we can do it. Therefore, we can keep all our rural population happy in their own places as well.
So, Mande sir, we are extremely thankful to you for your very lucid presentation and how we can come out through this pandemic, and also how can we help India being Atmanirbhar through the various activities that CSIR Lab has taken up. So we are extremely thankful to you for taking your time off, and also through your illustrative slides, how we can move forward. We thank you. We also wish to place our gratitude to Sri Jayantiji Sahasrabuddhe, Secretary General of Vijnan Bharati, who is a constant source.
The question that someone has asked, that if you want to make it happen in India, whom should we approach? And that's a question. What I would like to suggest to many of you is that contact the closest unit of Vigyan Bharati in your prant. And Vigyan Bharati is a very, very committed organization for the development of Bharat. So your prant, Vibhag, whosoever it is, please contact Vigyan Bharati. Vigyan Bharati will be able to connect you to the correct kind of people. If you have to resolve to do things collectively for the development of our own nation, if you have to resolve to make Bharat an Atmanirbhar Bharat, Vigyan Bharati has a very important role to play as an organization that can take all the technological solutions to the common people. And therefore, I would like to appeal to all of you that please do contact Vigyan Bharati. If you reside outside India, the GIST forum that is here, and Dr. Yellowji Rao is coordinating, please feel free to write to the GIST forum, and we'll be happy to connect with all of you. May I request Srikanji to take over? You will have to unmute yourself, Srikanji. We couldn't hear you last time you were speaking. No, you are muted. Shikanti, you are muted.
Yeah. Can I?
No, we can't hear you. Hello?
Hello.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, namaste. I am Srikant Kulkarni from Vijnan Bharati Pune, and I am also a volunteer of GIST India Forum. Now, we just heard that GIST India Forum is a collaborative platform comprising of Indian scientists and technocrats with Indian diaspora spread across the world, using science and technology as a vehicle to develop the solutions for our developmental problems of our country. Dr. Mande, sir, who could have been a better person heading all the 37 CSIR labs in the country to give guidelines for bringing out the concept of self-reliant India, the dream project of our Prime Minister? Various actions that you illustrated, taken up, initiated by CSIR labs, is a testimony of what we can do. We are indeed indebted to you, sir, for your illustrious talk and in this maiden webinar series of this forum. We thank you for taking time off from your schedule, and really, we thank you all. We also wish to place our token of gratitude to Sri Jayantaji Sahasrabuddhe, who is the Secretary General of Vijnan Bharati and who is a constant source of inspiration for all we volunteers. We are grateful to all the volunteers from GIST India Forum, GIST UK Forum, GIST USA Forum, for their efforts in organizing in this maiden webinar. We sincerely grateful to all the participants in the webinar and request their continued support to make this GIST movement a truly collaborative platform in search of solutions for the development of Bharat. Now, we have decided to hold a monthly webinar on the topic of self-reliant Bharat on the last Saturday of every month. And in due course, suitable notices will be sent to everyone. So we request all of you to register yourself so that we can keep on communicating with you. Now, to end this program, I wish to recite a prayer from Rig Veda. It says, Sangachadvam Samvadadvam Samvo Manansi Janatam Deva Bhagam Yatha Purve Sanjanana Upasate Samanu Mantra Samiti Samani Samanam Mana Sahachittamesham Samanam Mantram Abhimantra Evaha Samanena Vo Havisha Juhomi Samaniva Akutihi Samana Hridaya Nivaha Samanamastu Vo Mano Yathava Susahasati. The meaning of this is, let us all walk together, let us talk together, let our minds apprehend together, common be our prayers, common be the purpose, common be the oblations, common be our intentions, common be our heart's wishes, common be our thoughts, so that there is a union among all of us. Dhanyavad. Can I take this back to the studio, please?
Done. Completed. Thank you so much, everyone.
Shall we leave the studio?
Nanda Kumar ji.